Hello, and thank you for joining us on Newsnight. Now, the quest to revive Nigeria's energy sector is at its height, given the huge impact it has on the economy. Now, that has led to suggestions of multiple options, including nuclear energy, which has drawn mixed reactions, top of which is the safety factor. Now, the assurance of safety and security of the use of radioactive materials in the country is a responsibility that cuts across different organizations, including the organization hosting the nuclear facility. But in general, the Nigeria Nuclear Regulatory Agency has a responsibility for regulating practices involving the use of ionizing radiation in the country. My guest is convinced that nuclear energy can be used in the nation's energy mix and safely too. He considered it cheaper and less hazardous because it is highly regulated. Newsnight sat down with Professor Yusuf Ahmed, a Director General of the Nigeria Atomic Energy Commission. Professor Yusuf Ahmed, thank you for speaking with us on Newsnight.
It's a pleasure having me on your program.
And you know, before we came on air, we've had this conversation where you've proven to be a very versatile person, and your commission, the Nigeria Atomic Energy Commission, many would not understand the versatility that is involved in the atomic energy space.
Yes.
So let's start off from there. What's the good in the atomic energy space?
Thank you very much. It's a pleasure, and welcome to Nigeria Atomic Energy Commission. I think one of the things that we usually tell Nigerians is that in the atom, there is a lot of benefits to mankind and humanity. And in fact, immediately after the World War II, everybody in the world realized that there is ways you can use the atom for peaceful purposes. And these peaceful purposes will help humanity in developing technology, in solving some of our problems, environment, health, agriculture, water resources, and so many things for the betterment of mankind. Mm. It will also help our economy. So they have come together in the United Nations to establish International Atomic Energy Agency. That agency was saddled the responsibility of using atoms for peace and development. Mm. That is where the history starts.
So
now, yes.
Okay, no, go ahead.
So if you look at that, then everybody in the world is encouraged to explore, harness the atomic energy for that peaceful purposes and for development. Mm. Now, coming back to Nigeria, how is that applicable to us? I must confess to you, Nigeria, way back in 1964, has become a member of the International Atomic Energy Agency. And since 1964, the International Atomic Energy Agency has been helping Nigeria through their own regional projects, through the international projects, through the national projects, to be able to design high-impact projects that will affect or touch positively the lives of Nigerians. Now, one will be wondering, atom, yes, you can use it for military purposes because of the enormous energy that an atom has. Once you bombard the atom, the energy that is released can be used either for military purposes or for peaceful purposes.
You know, now, yes. The moment anybody hears atomic energy,
yes,
atom, what comes to mind is Hiroshima. The atomic, the nuclear bombs,
yes,
the radiation that's a product of using atomic energy or nuclear energy around wherever you are. So, is that something to be afraid of? I mean, in the bid to use the atom for development and for the good of mankind, should we be afraid or concerned about radiation issues?
No, at all. Let me make this clear. You see, every object on earth, whether it's a mineral, whether it is air, whether it is water, whether it is fire, and so on, there's a way you can use it positively, there's a way you can use it negatively. People are being drawn by water, but you cannot survive without water. Fire escalates and burn places, but we can't live without fire. I'm just giving symbolism. Mm-hmm. So it depends on how we use it. Now, in an atom, the energy that the atom release and the radiation that the atom release, you can harness these two things. You can harness the heat that is being released in form of energy that is being released from the atom when you break the atom to generate electricity through your steam and running your turbines. And you have a nuclear power and it can power your houses and industries. You can use the radiation that comes with the energy to beam it to a tumor, to a cancerous cell, and you kill those cells and you cure humanity. You can beam it to our perishable foods to destroy the microbes, the bacteria that makes those agricultural products ferment or destroy those agricultural products, and you increase the shelf life. You can beam it on medical instruments to sterilize them, and then you can reuse it. You can beam it on the earth to go and be reflected with either water, oil, or whatever minerals that is down there. And you explore and say, I have so-so deposit of oil, I have so-so deposit of water, I have so-so deposit of minerals. So it depends on where you direct the energy or the radiations that come from the atom. And this is what nuclear scientists and engineers all over the world is focusing on. The United Nations have made so much treaties to discourage people from using the radiation and the heat that is coming out from atom for military purposes, but encouraging people to explore more avenues for the peaceful applications to develop our own humanity.
So let's bring it home here.
Yes.
You've talked about using the atomic energy for development.
Yes.
And for good.
Yes.
Can it be used for power generation?
Exactly.
Effectively so.
Efficiently.
Because I do know that it's been used to power ships and submarines and
exactly.
all of that. But now we're talking about domestic power generation.
Exactly.
Domestic use. How easy is that?
So I will talk in a way that a layman can understand.
Which is why I asked the question. Ask yes. the question in a layman yes. way.
So that enormous energy that an atom has. You take a 1 kg of an atom, and you want to burn that 1 kg of an atom of uranium or plutonium. You want to measure the energy you get from that 1 kg. The only equivalent that you can get, you have to burn 10,000 tons of coal for you to get that equivalent of that 1 kg. So look at the huge thousands of coal, kilograms of coal you need to burn to get energy equivalent of that 1 kg of uranium or plutonium. This is showing you the reciprocal. Now, if you ask me about nuclear power, as I've earlier said, if you split an atom of a uranium or plutonium or any of the fissile materials, it will break into two deltas with 2 to 3 newtons coming out and with a huge energy coming out. Now, this energy that is coming out, you can harness it, collect the energy with the cooling system that you are using, you will create steam through steam generators. And this steam that comes from the energy of the atom will run your turbines and you can generate electricity. So if you have a system that can ensure self-sustaining chain reaction of the atom. When I say self-sustaining, maybe I have to explain a little bit so that our layman can understand. The principle of nuclear fission, breaking of atom into its deltas. There is another one, nuclear fusion, which is a new technology now to also generate electricity, which is bringing lighter atoms together. You force them together and they release energy, and you also get energy from that. We'll discuss that later. But when you go to nuclear fission, the one that you are talking about, generating electricity from atom of uranium or fissionable materials, if that atom split into deuters, it gives you two deuters and then 2 to 3 more neutrons. And those 2 to 3 more neutrons will bombard the neighboring atom again to split, to give you two. So if you did not control that chain reaction, it will escalate. It means the reaction will go into a runaway situation. So it means you need moderators in the environment where you are having fission chain reaction.
Do we have that controlled environment to even begin to consider nuclear? We're talking about yes. the hydro station
as a country,
as a country. Hydro power plant. We don't have enough, or where they are somewhat moribund, or they are not adequately equipped.
Yeah.
The transmission grid continues to collapse by once in a while. The distribution companies are not able to distribute power to the nation.
Yes.
The Nigerians who are using power are not able to pay for power because they are not metered. The meter manufacturers say they don't have enough meters. All manner of things going on. And you're talking about bringing in another source of energy to meet this the power need of Nigeria.
So let's take it from ground zero. When I said Nigeria has joined IAEA in 1964 to use peaceful applications for nuclear science and technology, we have ventured into all aspects of peaceful applications except the military aspect. So you have the power and the non-power. In the non-military aspect, you have the power and the non-power. I will discuss the non-power separately later. But the power aspect that we are talking about, you see, it is a reactor, nuclear reactor that you are going to use in generating the electricity. So what we did, we said, why don't we go into a research reactor first? Train our people on how to operate, utilize, maintain a reactor. And a research reactor is the same as a power reactor, except that this one, you are interested in the heat that is being generated to run your turbines and generate electricity. But this one, you are interested in the neutrons that are coming, maybe I call it radiations that are coming, to bombard materials and explode their content. So in a nuclear reactor that is research-oriented, the heat is your nuisance. You have to find a way of eradicating the heat. But in a power reactor, is the neutrons. You have to find the way to contain the neutrons and the radiation. So we have been running a research reactor in Nigeria since early 2000. To be precise, 2003, we have had a research reactor. And since that, we are running this reactor in our Center for Energy Research and Training in Zaria successfully without problems. And I want to assure you, and I want to tell you that you can find out that no foreigner is working in our laboratory in Zaria running this reactor and its auxiliary facilities. All are Nigerians who are trained in this facility, who handles the maintenance, who handles the operation, and who handles the utilization. People like us were brought up from that facility. From the scratch, when we are constructing this facility in the 90s, to the time that we have commissioned it, we have finished the construction in 2003. By 2004, we have started operation with that facility.
Nigeria has a reactor.
Nigeria has a research reactor, a nuclear research reactor. And that facility is helping us for geochemical mapping, for agricultural soil fertility mapping, for mineral exploration, for so many things using the method they call neutron activation analysis.
Mm. So that tells me that, and to run that reactor, you're using uranium.
We are using uranium. In fact, when we commissioned this reactor, we were using a highly enriched uranium. Okay. And now we have converted it to a low enriched uranium. And so this facility The core of the facility has been working successfully since its commissioning. And it's all Nigerians doing that. And you have never had any incident.
In the 90s.
Construction started in the 90s, but we commissioned in 2003, yes.
Okay, so since 2003, this reactor has been running.
Yes.
We've not had any issues of radiation. We've not had any issues of accidents.
No.
And you say it's Nigerians that are running this.
Yes, there's a regulatory authority.
So why is it that we don't have... Oh, but it's not gone into energy power generation here.
Exactly.
It's just research.
Research.
So far, you've just been using the reactor to do, as you say, geomapping,
soil fertility.
Soil fertility.
Training humans, Nigerians in the field of operation, maintenance, and nuclear engineering, nuclear science.
Okay.
Yes.
And all of these are just lying there. When it can not, be used? Because...
Not lying, but what I'm saying is that what we did in Nigeria is a government policy. We want to transit from a research reactor to a power reactor. Now, the wisdom is that if you want to train somebody how to drive, you cannot give him the best of your car to learn on it. Even in learning schools, I'm sorry to say the worst cars you see on the road is from the learning schools. But why is because a learner, you always see him trying to explore. And in the process, he needs something that is inherently safe. Inherently safe with so much defense in depth. So that silly mistakes or near miss can still be accommodated. And by the time he becomes a perfect, because the operation starts from trainee operator to operator B, to senior operator, before you become a reactor manager. And people like us have followed all these two processes. So by the time you have understood it and got grasp of it, transitioning to a power reactor
will not be a challenge.
Of course.
Where is this reactor located?
It's Ahmadu Bello University, Zaria, at the Center for Energy Research and Training.
What's the capacity as it is now when you transition it to a power reactor?
Exactly.
Can it serve the entire nation?
Yes, so one thing with power reactors, they have their capacities. Now, what is your energy requirement?
You want us to look at Nigeria's energy requirement,
yes.
Right?
So
now,
if your energy requirement, one power reactor cannot be adequate for Nigeria. That's why most of the countries that you see building units, you need to build 2 to 3 or 4 units. Because, example, a 1,200 megawatts unit, if you want to go for maybe 8,000 megawatts, 10,000 megawatts, you need to have some few units. Siting the units in one place or in different places depends on your national policy. As a commission, we have looked at Nigerian environment and scenario. We have identified more than 10 sites that are suitable for nuclear power. From Yauri in the northwest to Lau in the northeast, to Gregu, North Central, to Itu, Akwa Ibom, South. There are so many potential places in Nigeria that can host nuclear power plants. We have advised government on that. And they said, why don't we zero into 2 potential sites with high parameters that can accommodate? We have zeroed to Gregu in Kogi State and Itu in Akwa Ibom State. Say, okay, fine. So if you have these sites, why not you also do feasibility study, environmental impact assessment, business model, economic models, so that you attract investors, because it's a huge business. We'll come to that. But what I want to tell you is that since Nigeria said they are going to use electricity, nuclear for peaceful purposes, and since we are members of IEA, International Atomic Energy Agency has given infrastructural issues that ones need to complete before you build a power plant. But yes.
Let's pull back a little bit.
Yes.
So far, our reactor has been used for more or less survey, right?
Research, yes.
Geological research, survey, research and training, research and, training and yes. all. So we know we have
a pool of manpower.
a pool of manpower.
Exactly.
We also know we have the resources to run the plant. Should we decide to build 10, 20 plants in Nigeria, maybe in small sizes?
Yes, yes.
We have the resources in uranium enough to run this.
Not resources in human. Yes.
But we also have enough uranium to run this plant.
This one we will discuss in uranium because it's a fuel. It comes with the plant. Yes. Mm-hmm.
But then, why I'm bringing this up now is the fact that a lot of illegal mining
is going on.
Is going on.
Exactly.
And it's been tied to uranium. I mean, at one time, just around the election period, one of the candidates of one of the political parties, I don't remember which one, talked about the fact that foreigners are mining Nigeria's uranium because it's considered one of the highest quality uraniums in the world. And that's and they're selling that illegally.
Well, I don't want to jump into that because I'm yet to get official communication from either Nigerian Geological Survey, either Nigerian Nuclear Regulatory Authority, or either the Mines Ministry.
Okay.
But what I want to inform you is that our neighbor Niger is one of the world's largest uranium exporters. Then two, our fringes in the far north frontiers, those states in the far north frontiers, neighboring Niger and also neighboring Cameroon and Chad, there are deposits
of uranium.
Potential deposits.
Okay, so now you didn't let, I didn't get to the question, but it's good that you brought this in.
Yes.
Because I was going to go to, in thinking of or considering the positioning of this plant, should you've made recommendations that have been made, E2 and Kogi, one would think that you'd consider putting them close to where you have deposits of uranium. I mean, states like Adama, Bauchi, Bayelsa, Benue, Cross River, Gombe. These are states that are known to have deposits of uranium, right?
No, I think it is not like that. It doesn't work like this.
Okay.
You see, it's like you are trying to tell me that for me to own a car, I must get my car near a factory that produces tire. It doesn't work like that.
No, agreed. But yes. Would it be easier?
Well, see, the bone of contention is that ordinary uranium you get from the soil is 99% or 98% to be precise, fertile, only 2% enriched. Meaning that if you get uranium from the soil, if you mine it, there are so many processes required before it becomes fuel. Filtration, you go to separation, you go to enrichment, then you go to fuel fabrication, pelleting, then it becomes useful to the reactor. One of the things that many people in the world are arguing today, can we allow everybody to enrich uranium? Because if you allow me to enrich uranium, I may use it for military purpose or I may use it for reactor purpose. There are no controls. So that are the issues with Korea and Iran. Today, Iran said they are using it. I'm sorry to cite these countries, but I'm just for you to understand. Iran kept saying that we're enriching our uranium for peaceful applications, for their reactors. But international community say, wait, what you are enriching, you can also use it for military purpose. The same thing with Korea. So the enrichment of uranium is highly controlled. Tell me your orders if you want to fabricate fuel. I can give you your orders already enriched or in a mixed form for your fuel. So you can build a fuel fabrication plant. Nobody can stop you with your vendor partners. And then the vendor partner can supply you the ingredients required for fabrication of your fuel. So sustainability of fuel is no longer a problem in this country or all over the world. The vendors have a way of supplying you with fuel. And these fuels are something that if you buy now, you don't consume them, you don't replenish them like every year, no. You stock and it takes you years.
Okay, so in other words, we need to look at the mining processes so far in Nigeria.
Exactly. I agree completely with you that the mining processes in Nigeria, our commission, one of the mandate of our commission in the Act 46 of 1976 that created our commission. One of the key functions of the commission is to mine radioactive minerals for peaceful purposes. We can do it in collaboration with business partners. We can do it as a commission. We can encourage people to do it. We can collaborate with Ministry of Mines or Geophysical Survey, Nigerian Mining and Geosciences or whatever. But what I'm trying to say is that venture of mining uranium is a matter of policy in the country. If the federal government wants to explore and exploit uranium, then we have to start looking at those deposits. You may be saying that they said in the news that you have deposit here and there. But I want to ask this question. And anybody that says about deposits of uranium, ask him this question. Is the deposit big enough to be of economic value? If it is not of economic value, then exploring that and exploiting that will not be cost efficient. You are better off getting your material for your reactor ready-made from the countries that produce those materials.
Mm. Okay. So your commission here right now, and the things you do, your major mandate, create framework for the use of atomic and nuclear energy for peaceful purposes in Nigeria. And you've been doing that. One of the major peaceful things, peaceful purposes that we need is power.
Yes.
We need our industries to run.
Yes.
We have a reactor.
Yes.
But it's for research.
Yes.
And we're hoping to transit.
Yes.
To a power reactor.
Yes.
There are plans to build two power reactors when we get to that point. That's what you're saying, right?
There's plan to build four power reactors in two locations.
Four power reactors in two locations.
Yes.
That could power the entire nation.
Yes.
What's the timeline for this?
Okay, thank you very much. I think this is what we now focus so that Nigerians will understand how far we have gone on that. One good thing is that in 2006, when our commission was activated by Joe, the mandate he gave us worked for a framework to ensure that Nigeria, along with the Niger Delta Power or whatever holdings, to make sure that Nigerians also have electricity from nuclear. So we started that. We created, we buy into the International Atomic Energy milestones, roadmaps. We started building the nuclear infrastructures. The nuclear infrastructure has to do with human capital, safety, security, emergency preparedness, and management systems, and government commitments, and 19 infrastructural issues.
This matter of, yes, you've talked about Nigeria and the partnerships you've had that helped to do training and completing the second phase, you called it, the state of infrastructure. So what is the commission thinking, or what are you thinking, or what's being done to manage the anxieties of Nigerians and to let them see where we're going, not where we are or where we used to be. These days you hear about nuclear plants in places and little or no radiation whatsoever.
Yes, exactly.
So what's going on?
I think I agree with you, because this is one major problem all over the world about nuclear. Now, the cultural behavior of people, the environment, the anxiety that the nuclear weapons created and the nuclear accidents also created made many people feel, does it worth it? But I always ask this question whenever I meet with some of responsible and even our government officials who ask, hey, Nigeria Atomic Energy Commission, what are you doing? I hope you are not doing nuclear weapons. We say, no, our mandate is peaceful application of nuclear science and technology. So they then ask, what about the waste that being generated from nuclear? What about the accidents? And what about this? To be candid to you, nuclear reactors and nuclear facilities all over the world are one of the regulated facilities. Why? It's because they have built-in safety steps and security steps physical protection systems that will ensure that these facilities are not compromised. And two, did not have accidents. Majority of our problems all over the world in the nuclear industry, particularly some of us that read from our degree up to PhD, nuclear physics, and become professors of nuclear physics, whatever we see, 80% is human errors. It's not facility error. This is to tell you that inherent safety features are built in our reactors. Containments are built in our reactors, whether it is a research reactor or a nuclear reactor or a power reactor. Both of them have those safety features built in. This is what we call defense beyond design, defense in depth.
Mm-hmm.
So I want to assure Nigerians through media houses like yours who have the reach out to support us in educating Nigerians that there are many more peaceful applications of nuclear science and technology. Apart from the power aspect that we are discussing now, there's a non-power aspect, which ordinary Nigerian, majority of us have gone through that. You go for a scan, you use nuclear techniques, you don't say, I have used nuclear. But it's nuclear technology. You go for radiotherapy, radiodiagnosis, medical physics, oncology, you use nuclear technology, but nobody shout about that. You can see it clearly in a hospital. They call this one radiology department. They use nuclear technology in that department. But you yourself, you go for scan, you don't bother. It is only when we want to build a reactor to generate electricity to support our own life, somebody will say, ah, nuclear. But what about those pieces of equipment? They are all under regulatory control. I want to tell you this. All of them in the hospitals are under regulatory control because they expose people to ionizing radiation.
But so you're saying that there's no need to worry.
There's no need.
There are many again who think, no, Nigeria, come on, don't give me that. What about safety, security, and all of that?
There is no need. Safety, security, safeguard are these elements that can never be compromised. A whole institution called Nigerian Nuclear Regulatory Authority has been established to ensure this. To ensure that those of us who are promoters of nuclear science and technology, who are owners of nuclear facility, to ensure that we do our work in a safe, secure, and protected manner. That's why they have to license us to do what we are doing. That's why we have critical positions. If you are an operator of a nuclear facility or any of our critical facility, you are on a critical position. And you have to undergo vetting, you have to undergo checks, medical checks, alcohol check, so many checks. If you are found wanting in any of it, they will remove you from the critical position. We are afraid, we don't want to allow people with access, with knowledge, and with authority to rule a facility that can make Nigeria, because a nuclear accident is not a Nigerian accident. It's the global accident because it doesn't know borders. You remember what happened in Ukraine that time?
Yeah.
Chernobyl.
Yes.
It contaminated the whole of Europe. So this is a typical example for you. So there is obligation on all countries that are having nuclear facilities.
But it is the stories of the Chernobyls of this world that are causing many Nigerians to say, please keep this away from this country. But recently we heard that there's a partnership with the EU as regards this same matter of safety, exactly, security, and all of that. How's that working out?
Yeah, thank you for that. So in line with that, and considering Nigeria's ambition to have nuclear power plants, not only nuclear power plants, in the medical field, we have exploited and explore to see that major problem that we have in our hospital today is radiodiagnosis, medical radiodiagnosis kits like the iodine, molybdenum, technetium that they use in trying to scan human bodies and see the problems. Radiotherapy, in trying to use nuclear medicine to treat people of cancer and other things. Now, when we ask ourselves, if you need a radio tracer, we call them radio tracer, if you need a radio tracer to inject into a human body to be able to see tumors and malignants and problems, why is the nearest reactor that can give you those radiopharmaceutical tracers? It's South Africa. And these radio tracers were designed to have short half-life, so that when they inject it into your body, after seeing it, it will go out of your body and it will decay down. So it doesn't have a long half-life. So it means if you are to produce it somewhere, you have to prepare your patient ready. You have to prepare your flight ready, so that by the time you produce from facility, you put into the flight, quickly come, and then the patient is already at the hospital, you inject him before the... So many patients are missing this singular diagnostic tool that could have identified so many ailments and saved so many lives.
All because we do not have a...
So we took it to ourselves that we are going to build a multipurpose research reactor in our nuclear technology center here in Abuja, so that it can produce radioisotopes for the West Africa and Central African states. Already, North Africa, Egypt have a reactor, and they are trying to produce those radioisotopes. So the market for Central Africa and West Africa is still virgin. And if that singular reactor comes, only God knows how many lives Nigeria can save, apart from making business with it. So now let's come to safety. So these two ambitions, a multipurpose research reactor for nuclear medicine and a nuclear power plant for electricity generation, attract the attention of the international community to Nigeria. Please, we are not saying you don't have right to build it or own it or utilize it, but we want to support you to upgrade your regulatory capability, your safety and security capability. So they are bringing intervention to our regulatory authority. Nigerian Nuclear Regulatory will be the one to anchor it. So the Nigerian Nuclear Regulatory Authority will use the support to ensure that from our hospitals to our oil companies to our research centers, wherever there is a nuclear facility, safety, security, and physical protection is enhanced. So that is the intervention they are bringing. So maybe if you want to know more about it, you can reach out to the Nigerian Nuclear Regulatory Authority. They will tell you their own breakdown of some of the components, how they are going to utilize this intervention. But the intervention is to support Nigeria's infrastructure in ensuring safety and security, so that all these new facilities that are coming up, they will meet up an environment that is ready to support the infrastructure.
So now you have the EU support, but yet we're not where we want to be.
Exactly. That is my worry.
In terms of policy.
Exactly. Now you are coming.
In terms of policy, we're not there, but we want to be there. So what would it take to get us to that place where we need to get?
Exactly. So now, looking at all these scenarios and the operational environment of Nigeria, particularly for those of us who have worked with many atomic energy commissions all over the world, particularly for those of us who have been working for IAEA on ensuring some of these things are done in a proper way across many countries. When you are back home, when you are seated as chief executive of the Atomic Energy Commission in Nigeria, and you are saddled with the responsibility, do what you have been doing outside the country for your country. You have only two issues to tackle. Get the government buy-in. Let it be government policy to make sure that Nigeria will utilize the atomic energy in solving its energy crisis. Number one, the 1976 law that you are using for your commission need to be reviewed so that you accommodate the new technologies, the new issues like waste management. What will you do with the waste that the nuclear power plant can generate? You need to also accommodate or domesticate the conventions and treaties, international conventions and treaties regarding application of nuclear science and technology. You also need to know how are you going to do compensation in case of nuclear accident. Nuclear damage and nuclear accident, all this compensation can come in. So now, number one is we need to ensure that the policy, government policies and programs, including strategic plans, development plans of Nigeria, captured this issue of nuclear science and technology for the purpose of electricity generation. We also need, the second thing, to convince our decision makers the fact that nuclear is one of the most cleanest energies and it can give you the best lot required. So why not can't we integrate it into our energy mix? We're not saying that nuclear power plants to replace all the hydros, all the whatever. It's a government decision. The best we are saying is, can we have a basket that consists of all these energy sources for our security, for energy security, and for energy sustainability? Once we do that, the rest are details because we have the required people, we have the required technology, and we have the partners that are willing and ready to support us. I must confess to you, Russia and China, today they are willing to support Nigeria strongly. All we need is to put our house in order. And how do we put our house in order? To get the required support from government. Once we get the support, we do feasibility studies, including business plan, and you will begin to see international community coming in to say, okay, I'm interested. This is what I'm in. Then how do we do? You open your bid, you get the best deal. So I think there's a way out. If we can get the buy-in of the government in putting it as part of strategic national plan, then we are good to go.
So as we wind down now, what's the future? I mean, what's the future for the use of gamma irradiation? What's the future of nuclear technology in our power sector? That's what we're focused on, but we also know that we're trying to pull it to the health side, to security, and what's the future and how do we get there? Because right now, Nigeria needs all the help it can get.
The future is bright. The decision Nigeria took by having Nigeria Atomic Energy Commission is a decision in the right direction. There are countries that don't even have the commission. And when they talk to international communities that they want to have nuclear power, they say, oh, come on, for God's sake, who is responsible? Many countries don't have even a commission, Atomic Energy Commission. So we took the first decision, and it's the right decision. The second decision we took is our National Nuclear Energy Program. The government of Goodluck Jonathan has approved our National Nuclear Energy Program. And all the peaceful applications, including the non-power in agriculture for the gamma irradiation facility, in health for the radiotherapy, radiodiagnosis, and whatever, in water resources for isotope hydrology, in environment for plastic pollution control and mitigations, in industry for material testing and sterilizations and whatever, we have took those decisions. Now, the third phase is to fund this nuclear energy program, to fund it in such a way that you achieve your milestones. And this is why we're having challenges now. Had it been this industry is well funded, fully funded as required, we could have been running our reactors by now.
So why is it not fully funded or well funded?
It's a government decision. Look at UAE. United Arab Emirates, they didn't have even required manpower to run nuclear power plants like Nigeria. But because the government is committed, they sunk in money, they even employed people that will work for their industry foreigners.
And some of them are Nigerians.
Some of them are Nigerians. Foreigners came to UAE, built the power plants for the UAE, and are operating the power plants for UAE. It is now that UAE started training their people to take over from those foreigners. But Nigeria, you already have a reactor. You have the experience. You have already trained your manpower. Thousands of people were trained already. You don't need a foreigner to come and operate any facility. You need to just support it, get it running, and your people can. Apart from that, nuclear technology creates a lot of jobs. A lot of jobs. Sprinkler industries that will come up to fabricate small consumables that this industry required are huge. A typical power plant between artisans, operators, managers, and whatever, you need up to 2,000 people. A typical power plant. Now, by the time you want to build 4 power plants, you have 8,000 people that you are going to employ. And these people, from the electricity they generate, they will pay themselves. You don't need to pay them from government coffers. If you create a power plant, nuclear power plant, there is what we call National Nuclear Power Plant Management Authority. You create an authority, like NNPC. They run themselves. They run the reactors. They generate their money. They pay themselves.
What would be one word you tell Nigerians as regards nuclear energy and all these affairs?
I thank you. I think what we are going to say now is that with all these explanations, Nigerians should understand that one of the safest technology that has inherent safety features in it, that is well regulated and controlled, is nuclear technology. Yes, there are fears of what if, but I want to assure you that we have operated a research reactor for many years without a near miss. And that reactor is still operating. We have handled highly rich uranium with that reactor and nothing happened. Therefore, when you come to power reactors, they are the same with research reactors, but on a bigger scale. And this one is to generate electricity, the other one is to do research and training. And we have trained a lot of Nigerians in the field of nuclear engineering, nuclear science and technology. Nigeria is ready to venture into the new horizon of bringing in nuclear energy into its energy mix. And that will solve a lot of energy problems and energy crisis. Not only that, it will guarantee the sustainability of our energy. We have started working on our national grid. The Germans and the Siemens are working on our national grid to expand the national grid. So it means government has already taken a policy direction to expand the grid so that the new generation reactors will come into it. We may decide not to go into a large-scale nuclear power plants. There are small modular reactors as options, compact modular reactors which can power a city or an industrial setup, which can power a difficult to reach areas. And all these are options in the nuclear environment that can solve our energy crisis. And once we get that right, I'm guaranteeing you our economic stability will come up.
Thank you very much, Prof. Yes. Thank you once again.
It's a pleasure. Thank you.
As we conclude today's program, we extend our gratitude for joining us. Your opinions on this discussion matter to us, and you can engage with us through our social media channels displayed on your screen. Additionally, you can listen to this episode and the past episodes of the program via our website at channelstv.com/podcast. I'm Neo Taigwe saying bye-bye.